here in New South Wales for the last few years, we've been on the movement in place journey in sort of the road and the management of the roadside and looking at how that all comes together. And I saw the Smart Places agenda really as an extension of that. I also thought using place breaks down some of the stereotype that can come around smart cities, because I see this as something that is equally relevant to small regional towns as it is to large metropolitan areas. So Smart Places in our narrative was about creating an equalising framework from the start and also connecting it to place, whether that be a park or public space, whether it be a street, whether it be a new suburb, whether it be a CBD, they're all places. And I think the principles we're talking about with the application of technology are fairly consistent across all of them.
Hi, Smart Community friends. In this episode of the Smart Community Podcast, I have a fabulous conversation with Simon Hunter, the Executive Director of Strategy and Innovation at the New South Wales Department of Planning, Industry and Environment, or DPIE for short. Now, this group is leading the implementation of the New South Wales Smart Places Strategy to embed smart cities into the planning of urban and regional areas across New South Wales. Simon and I have a great talk about what New South Wales is up to in regards to smart communities and initiatives in the smart places space and the exciting future ahead. In this episode, Simon tells us about his background in transport and infrastructure, mainly in state government, and what a smart community is to him. Simon shares with us the importance of the term smart places and its use when discussing this space, as well as how he got into this space and how he has driven this concept over time with DPIE in his other roles. We talk about the polarising risks associated with data and privacy protection and how to balance them before Simon tells us about the Smart Places Acceleration Program and what is involved, as well as the benefits realisation of this program. We then discuss the importance of efficiency and value of time and how that contributes to people's quality of life, as well as the value that remote working and remote staff can bring to an organisation. We finish our chat with Simon telling us about what is happening over the next few years with his work and what he is most excited about. Now, this is the last episode for the year before we go into our summer series. So, as always, we hope you enjoy listening to this episode as much as we enjoyed making it.
Welcome to the smart community, smart regions, smart towns, and smart cities. It's where we live, work, and play. With smart communities, the future starts today. Big data, smart mobility, emerging trends galore. The Smart Community Podcast is what you're looking for.
Hello, Simon. How are you today?
Yeah, good morning, Zoe. I'm really well. And how are you?
I'm very well. I just got back from hot yoga, so, you know, and I had a coffee earlier, but I'm looking forward to my second one.
Excellent. I have a coffee and I've just returned from physio, so anything's better than that.
Nice. Well, let's just jump straight in. And can you tell us about your background and what you're passionate about?
Yeah, sure. So professionally, my background is largely government, but with a couple of years of consulting thrown in there. You know, I've worked in the transport portfolio probably for most of my time in government, but I've worked in infrastructure more broadly and in some social and regulatory roles as well. So yeah, mainly a government person. All of my government time has been in the state government here in New South Wales, and for the last 3 years, I've kind of been on the smart journey, thinking about how technology can make the most of our infrastructure, our services, and that led to the very much the Smart Places strategy, our action plan, and me building a team here in the New South Wales Department of Planning and Industry and Environment.
Mm. And I heard you were a professional sports person at one time in your life.
No, I'm a keen amateur who never had the speed or skill to make it, but I have some friends who are generous with the truth.
Okay, fair. Well, I'm glad that I brought that up then. So We're going to go broad because I know people will be super keen to hear about how the Smart Places team came to be and the strategy and all the really exciting but real work that you're doing. So we'll go broad first, though. So what is a smart community to you?
I think it's a place where technology is used to help drive achieving the community's hopes and dreams and aspirations. So it's a place where there's no digital divide. It's a place where data is captured, collected, housed, and made available to generate insights that help people, businesses, government, and anyone else who needs to make decisions about a place to do that. It's a place where you don't see the technology because it's so woven in to the community. It's a place where all of those outcomes that you want for the community, like green tree canopy, like safe streets, like shared spaces and things like that, can all be aided by technology. So, yeah, a smart place is just a place, but it's one with tech to enable it.
Mm-hmm. So we've talked about smart cities, now we're just about smart communities. You use the term smart place. Why was it important to use that term for you?
Yeah, I think it was important to connect it to the agenda of placemaking and of place as something that people really believe in. Here in New South Wales, for the last few years, we've been on the movement and place journey in sort of the road and the management of the roadside and looking at how that all comes together. And I saw the Smart Places agenda really as an extension of that. I also thought using place breaks down some of the stereotype that can come around smart cities, because I see this as something that is equally relevant to small regional towns as it is to large metropolitan areas. So smart places in our narrative was about creating an equalising framework from the start and also connecting it to place, whether that be a park or public space, whether it be a street, whether it be a new suburb, whether it be a CBD, they're all places. And I think the principles we're talking about with the application of technology are fairly consistent across all of them, although the technologies you want to deploy will be different depending on what you're trying to achieve.
Mm. And you've been on this kind of, I don't really like using the word journey, but I will. But you've been in this space for quite a long time. And we met, I think, in 2018, potentially. I know you were on this way before then. How did you come to be in this, smart places space? And why was it really important to you that this agenda kept moving? Because I imagine in the early days, it would have been quite hard to push this kind of agenda when people couldn't quite wrap their heads around, well, smart city, I don't understand what's happening, particularly in government. That really pushing this, and I don't want to say agenda because that has a bit of a negative connotation, but this concept that was so important, why was it so important to you?
Yeah, that is a good question. And the journey for me started in around about October 2017. We had been developing the 2018 State Infrastructure Strategy. I was at Infrastructure New South Wales at the time. And out of the blue, my CEO at the time, Jim Betts, got a letter from the Premier asking him to go to China and co-chair economic development discussion with our sister province, Guangzhou, in China, and for him to co-chair the smart cities stream. So we started looking at smart cities and what was happening in Australia and what particularly was happening in New South Wales, and identified some opportunities that we thought could be realised for the New South Wales government. At the time, in 2017, the Smart Cities and Suburbs program was really putting some air in the tyres of place-based applications of technology, funding a lot of really good pilots, and we were starting to see some momentum. And that was a Commonwealth initiative taken up by local government. The piece that was missing that I saw was state government. If you think about the amount of asset and services and policy work that a state government does, it seemed to me illogical that a smart cities movement was happening without state government playing. So when we looked at that, we went to this three-day economic development meeting in Guangzhou. And after that, I went to my CEO and said, look, I think there's an agenda here. I think there's a worthwhile research piece around what the role of state could be. He pushed that to the head of the Department of Premier and Cabinet, to the Premier, and we ended up putting a recommendation in the state infrastructure strategy that a strategy for smart cities or smart places be developed. I got quite passionate about it because I saw it as touching almost every sector and being a way of realising that vision of cities being systems of systems. And I saw the opportunity for the smart places and you know, ubiquitous access to connectivity, sharing of data to generate insights across multiple portfolio areas, being a way where we could connect the way state government thinks to the way local government thinks. So local government thinks purely about place, and then the functions come to enable that place, whereas state, we're organised in transport, in health, in education. So we think more in that functional silo. And I saw the Smart Places agenda as being a way of connecting that function with place and that vertical and horizontal. I don't know if we've nailed it yet, but I think we've got the right ingredients coming together.
Thanks so much for sharing that. I was really keen to hear that, but I think the audience will also be, because I think we don't often hear that piece of how this actually came to be, particularly for government strategies and policies and that type of thing, because it's like, well, where did this come from? And it can just come from one, like I said, went to this conference in China, and we're not taking the exact same approach, but we took the ingredients that we needed because we could see the potential. And I think in this world that we live in now that's quite polarizing, it's either that or that. There is so much grey, and that's what we really need to latch onto and grab our ingredients that we need to make it suit the places and the people in our communities, right?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. I think the other bit that I probably should have said when I talked about how we got here was by talking to a lot of people, and probably rather than talking, more listening to a lot of people. In 2018 particularly, and 2019, there are a lot of people talking about the benefits that could come from smart cities, whether they be from the research sector, from local government, or from the sort of vendor sector. And so when I was listening to those people, reading a lot, understanding that everyone saw the potential for it, but nobody probably had a silver bullet to deliver it, that was another thing that reinforced it for me. But the point you make there about it being quite polarizing, I think, is one that is worth teasing out. It's both polarizing in terms of the approach you should take, the technologies you should use, but also the level of privacy and sort of citizen rights protection. And, you know, you've worked across multiple jurisdictions, you've done overseas research. Who do you reckon is best balancing those potentially polarizing risks?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I think an obvious answer is Europe, and obviously Europe's a huge place, but just going to places like, you know, Amsterdam and even Barcelona, there's this level of understanding of what is and isn't personal information. And I think in Australia, we're still grappling with that, but and it's an education piece. And I think we're still thinking as privacy of this polarizing, like, oh, well, then nothing can happen. And like, I've had lots of privacy professionals on the podcast, particularly, you know, focusing in on that, because I that's not the case. And I think that's where we need to have more of those conversations, and that polarization doesn't help. But in saying that, like, we've got people here working in Australia on the privacy piece, and in America as well. And Europe sets this standard, but obviously now there's these other things in place that are really, I guess, important for us as consumers and privacy, but actually they've added another layer of understanding and tech and inconvenience or whatever to us, right? And I think that's a fix for now, because it's important that we protect our privacy of citizens and ourselves, but there's still a lot that we need to shift through and that we'll continue to move through. And I think in Australia, potentially it means that we can do some leapfrogging if we really get onto this agenda, so then we can make it really simple and streamlined. And again, no silver bullets, a bit like this whole space, but having those privacy professionals in from the very beginning and being able to explain what is and isn't, what we are and are not doing with the data is really important. What I've found is sometimes we don't, as you know, maybe a government agency or even a company or whatever, we don't have very good answers when people ask the question, what are you doing with my data? Because sometimes we are not 100% sure at that moment, or we think we're doing this, but actually we might do this, this, and this. And I think that's where we, if we can start having those better conversations and understanding the data, and I think having data professionals like data scientists or analysts, whatever, involved in those very early conversations too is really important. So yeah, I think it's really baking in from the beginning and be like, okay, well, what are we actually going to do? So you can ask some of those sticky questions at the very beginning. And it's not, because I think people were seeing those as like, oh, well, this person doesn't want this to happen when they're asking this. That's not the case. It's actually, we want to answer those questions, then we've got better answers for the community and other people involved.
Yeah, you got to have that growth mindset when you're doing strategy or setting new things, because you no one person's going to have the perfect answer to every question. We've thought a lot about the privacy and personal information side of things in New South Wales, and we've tried to be quite proactive and transparent in the Smart Places agenda about this. Anyone who sees my LinkedIn feed will have seen me talk about the Smart Places customer charter and what a great thing I think that is to really enshrine, as you say, at the design stage, in the principles that these are being places for people, not about them, that will protect their data. And I think specificity of use and purpose is so important. Being able to say that we are only going to use the COVID safe app data to contact trace to protect people's health, and we're not going to use it to sell it to people and say, you know, this person's interested in these five shops or these five cafes so you can market to them. That's a real clear responsibility of government, and that's why people use their QR codes to log in. I also want to make it really clear that in New South Wales, any initiative that goes up under our Smart Places Acceleration Program goes through a privacy impact assessment with the Privacy Commissioner looking over that and determining the impact. And I think that's a really important safeguard. If people are interested, our customer charter is on our website, and we are encouraging people to sign up. And we've had a really great response in the last 2-3 weeks since it's been released of people signing up. And I think for us, that tells a good story that this is something that the people in the community want, whether they be vendors, whether they be government agencies or councils.
Yeah, agreed. And, you know, in the work I've been doing recently with Camden in New South Wales, we also looked at the customer charter, and I think it is a really, really good piece to point to and really sets that foundation, which is so important. But I was going to say something around, we'll put the link in the show notes for so people can click and find the customer charter and can sign up there. I was going to say, you mentioned the Acceleration Fund?
Yeah, Acceleration Program.
Acceleration Program. Let's talk about that now. Can you tell us what that is for people who don't know?
Yeah, the Smart Places Acceleration Program is our chance to get some momentum going. It's a $45 million reservation that the New South Wales government put aside under the Digital Restart Fund. And it's about bringing forward the take-up of technology and the place-based application of that technology. It's really designed to create digital and data assets for New South Wales that drive forward implementing the Smart Places strategy. It's been going for about a year, I think a year in December. We have close to $20 million of the fund allocated now. We're starting to see some really cool initiatives come through it. And yeah, but we're only halfway through allocating it. So if people do have ideas, put up your expressions of interest. And we're really keen to deploy stacked technology and really create an innovation space in 2022.
Two questions. What type of initiatives are you seeing? And two, if people do want to get involved, can you just explain a little bit of how you're allocating those funds and those partnerships and that type of thing involved, right?
Yeah, absolutely. It is a co-investment fund. So the state government will co-invest with place owners. It requires a state government partner agency to hold the digital assets that are being created. But a place owner can be a local government, but it can also be a landowner, or it could be an owner of parks and public space facilities. Places defined quite broadly. We have an expressions of interest program that people can again go onto our website and lodge their EOI. It's best for us if you come with state agency partner and place owner and idea of what problem you're trying to solve already thought of, but we do a bit of a mix and match service when we see good ideas come through. That's the how. And then there are some really cool ideas coming through. There's an asset AI concept with a council and the transport agency really looking to understand road condition asset. There is, as you will know, the envisioning in 3D Camden and spatial services proposal, which I think is just absolutely awesome, as it really it takes this 4D spatial digital twin and then it applies a deeper place-based lens on it that I think is so replicable and repeatable, but also so good for giving the community a sense of what the future will look like to engage them meaningfully. So there are heaps of exciting projects. There's a Smart Curbs initiative that we're doing with Liverpool Council that, again, is one that I think could be repeated. And we've given some support to mapping of connectivity across the transport system and also to the Park and Pay program.
Yeah, and what I like about some of those ones that you've described there is that we're using stuff that we've invested in already. So the, you know, New South Wales digital twin, for example, Camden then building on that to make it more play space, as you said. And then because people are like, what are we going to use these things for? What, you know, what's the purpose or whatever? But it's actually building on those digital. I mean, it's just infrastructure, right? It's digital infrastructure that we've invested in. And what are we going to do with that to make it more applicable to our communities? So I love that. And I know there's like lots of other ones kind of floating around and, you know, more ideas happening as well. And I think, I mean, it's probably fairly obvious, but like, why was it so important for you to have that state-based partner as well? And what things are you seeing? What are people saying about that?
I don't know. I don't know that anyone would necessarily give me their 100% honest feedback if they hated the program.
True.
Without this money and this investment, I think we would still be struggling to get the amount of traction that we need to make this real. I think the 45 million reservation was a game changer, and I kind of feel like the opportunity is something that creates a huge obligation not to waste that opportunity. So we're really looking to make sure that we leave an asset base in place at the end of the three-year program that can be just baked into business as usual, so that the things we are investing in are continued after the startup seed funding finishes and they become assets that are held and maintained and invested in by agencies. This is about bringing things forward and getting things going. It's not an extra revenue line. So we're really looking to make sure that when we invest in something, it's because it's shown potential to be baked into business as usual. So there's an initiative under consideration now that, if it's successful, could strip a lot of time out of processes that are quite manual now. And so therefore it'll have 18 months of funding to kind of prove that it worked as a concept. And if that's the case, it'll realize ongoing savings that'll more than cover the costs of the digital asset. And that's the story that I think we need to be able to tell about the benefits realization. It's efficiencies, but it's also more effective ways of doing business. So we're providing a better citizen customer service as a result of this investment.
Yeah, and I think that's really important. And that's really come out in some of the work I've been doing recently, that customer experience. But to make it more efficient on both sides. So, you know, talking to the customer service team, they're like, well, on the front end, potentially there's this really nice app or whatever, but behind the scenes, we're running around trying to, like, you know, make it all work and plug it in the things. And making it more streamlined for the customer is always, you know, benefits for the community is always our end goal. But actually, there are still people working within, to say, it's a council or government agency. We want to make that more efficient, more effective, so then we can free up that time for, you know, brain space, but also just, you know, well-being, all those type of things. And I think we're starting to have those conversations now, which is really exciting, because I don't think when we first started this space, or in this space, that wasn't really a thought piece that was happening. It was kind of like community well-being, whatever, but we weren't quite sure how it was going to get there, you know, quality of life, those type of things. Whereas now I think we're having those better conversations, more mature conversations about what it actually can do to make things more efficient, more effective, but then how that then helps the people to be healthier, happier, safer, less, I guess, no one wants to be wasting time, right? Like we talk about millennials, you know, and I guess that's even old news now, Gen Z's, whatever, you know, not wanting to do things that aren't, you know, that they want purpose, right? We want purpose. And I think we can use digital to help us do that as well by not doing things that you're like, well, why am I doing this? Surely this could be done in a more effective way.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely part of it. I think the value of time is something that everyone can relate to. And whatever we can do, whether it's enabling you to work throughout your whole commute, if you are traveling to the office, that means maybe you have to spend less time actually tethered to the desk in the office, or whether it's that you can do a bit of multitasking by clearing some emails and watching kids run around in the park because there's really good connectivity in that park. There are lots of ways that we can do that. I am not sure, though, that we're in the right headspace yet to really take advantage of all of the applications of technology. I don't know about you, but 2 years worth of pandemic life, lockdowns and things like that, it's changed my worldview, but I don't know what my worldview ends up as being. I mean, I worked remotely one day a week prior to COVID, and I'm expecting that'll go up two and stay at two and three. But I know there are other people itching to get back in the office who have already raced back to the office. And right now, commuting 2 days a week, those commutes feel a lot longer than they did when it was what I did every day.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's something I've been thinking about a lot as well. And you described that so well. My worldview has changed, but I'm not quite sure what it is yet. And I don't think, I certainly haven't, and you probably haven't either, I had the breathing space to just go, okay, where are we at? What just happened in the last 2 years? And I'm sure a lot of people are in the same boat and completely different boats as well of completely changing, having to change because of the line of work they're in or you know, whatever their circumstances were. So I think there's it's going to be a lot of shifting and changing coming up in the next, maybe hopefully people will be able to take some time off over this coming period. But for me, I felt like we're just, it's busier than ever actually, because we've started kind of 2021, wasn't quite the same. We didn't, you know, the events and things that wasn't happening. And obviously we've still got ongoing COVID issues, but the confidence in, you know, okay, well, we're just going to keep moving forward, particularly, you know, working with government and those type of clients. We're progressing and actually we need this stuff done quite soon because we've waited some time or whatever. And consultants, we get it done, but not complaining. It's great. Love it. I love being busy.
You're a consultant and an engineer. Of course, you get to get it done.
But I am looking forward to breathing at some point, maybe early next year, and going, okay, what is this new worldview? Because the amount of people I've talked to on the podcast as well around the world, there's so many different things happening. But yeah, I think we're all kind of going, oh, where is it? The tables haven't quite stopped turning yet, I think. And yeah, it's interesting. And I also think that, so the commute thing, so I used to commute and my commute is very long to Brisbane. I used to do it one or 2 days a week. And I used to not like it because I kind of had to do it. And, you know, I went there for work or whatever. Whereas now I go for social things and then I tack work onto that. And it's because I'm working in New South Wales remotely essentially for this whole year, which has been great. But my team that I contract to, I just love seeing them and I'm not necessarily working directly with them, but we do bounce ideas with each other when we go into the office. So my view of commuting has changed to I'm driving down here for something super fun, which is hanging out with my work people as well as doing karaoke in the evenings or whatever. And so it's interesting because I'm like, oh, I actually don't mind the drive now because I listen to my podcast or whatever. Whereas, yeah, it's really shifted. Whereas my commute actually would detract from my well-being, whereas now it's neutral or even positive because I'm like, oh yeah, cool, I'm in my car, I'm listening to a podcast or whatever, you know. So it is interesting and people have so many different experiences. So I think, and I do think that when we talk, particularly in the early days, it was like very generalized of like, oh, well, this is good for everyone or this is bad for everyone. And I think we've realized now that that's not the case. And that's probably conversations we had earlier on as well. It was like, oh, well, this is the way it is. Whereas I think we're going to see much more flexibility, and being able to adapt, I think, will be a really key point as well.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. My approach to leadership and to working with people is to say to them really openly, I don't need to see you face-to-face in the office to work with you. If I do need that, then I'm obviously not a very good leader. I have a team that have people based in the Central Coast, in the Central West, in Orange, down on the South Coast, and places like that. I've had staff previously in and around Coffs Harbour and things like that. And I actually think that having more people who don't live in a metropolitan area in the thinking is a good thing, and that we should encourage and embrace that. Like, society is not all people living in metropolitan areas, so therefore government service delivery shouldn't be represented by them. I'm also really hoping that we can see the benefits of flexibility in terms of workforce participation for parents, satisfaction for people with parental and carer responsibilities and things, through us having proved that this technology works to support efficient work that's not only in the office. But like you, I've had a huge amount of energy boost in the last 3-4 weeks going into the office a couple of days a week. I've really enjoyed seeing people, connecting with teams, and just observing meetings and discussions that I'm not necessarily part of, to help understand what makes people tick. I think that's the more important thing than actually seeing people. It's getting that connection and understanding what makes people tick so that you can work most effectively together.
Yeah, I agree. And it's interesting, like, I had lots of conversations before the pandemic about remote work and that type of thing. And, you know, because like you, I used to remote work actually majority of my week. But, and particularly on the podcast, right, like, a lot of my guests I've never met in person, and probably and may never will. Oh, that's sad. No, I definitely will at one point. But it was like, oh, no, we need to meet. Like, the general vibe was, we need to meet first, build trust, then use digital. Whereas now it's, we need to meet digitally, build trust digitally, then we'll meet in person, which will is actually not a necessary thing, but it's a rich builds out like connection in a more rich way, because, you know, you can again, social cues, just be there and also be really excited because this wasn't possible before. And I think that vibe, then you can just build your relationship even more. And I think that flip has been a good one, like you said, because it then provides access to people that may not have been able to, you know, just jump on a plane or go somewhere or here or there. And also consultants that, not necessarily consultants, but people working within the community and other services offering, et cetera, that barrier no longer exists, because it doesn't mean that you are, it definitely, like, the vibe was definitely, if you are coming to me in person, you value this more than somebody who's going to, you know, Zoom in or whatever the case is. Whereas I think now people realize that that's not the case, and that it just works, it can work more effectively for everyone.
Yeah, I agree. I heard an analogy where the workplace has just followed the dating scene by about 10 years later. So it used to be in the dating scene that you saw people first, you connected that way, and then you swapped details and connected digitally or by phone later. And it was the same with the workplace. You worked in the office and then you shared emails afterwards, whereas now, you know, it's flipped. You don't get through to the meeting in person, as I understand it, until you are past some digital communications on the dating apps. And it's almost the same with work and meeting people now.
That's a great analogy, and I hadn't thought of that like that before. And I think that's very true, very true. Oh, it'd be interesting to see what's next. You know, have to be some kind of augmented reality or something. Anyway, keep moving on. I'm looking at the time. I'm really keen to, where have we gone? We've gone to the acceleration program. We've talked about your strategy a little bit, and we'll put all the links in the show notes. You've got a whole bunch of other, I guess, works happening in the next kind of 3 years. What are you most excited about?
I think the future of the street and the change to the narrative that 5G small cells is going to bring forward is probably the biggest opportunity and the thing that I'm most excited about. Like, that there are multifunctional smart poles, that there is enabled digitally connected street furniture, and that we use it to generate data that can help really push the concept of place-based technology forward. So I think that's the opportunity. I think the challenge is who owns the assets, how we make sure the assets are commissioned, how we bring in the telcos and bring them into the place agenda as we deliver it is all really important. I also think continuing to build and maintain that community trust is at the core of it, and making sure we don't miss the opportunity. We don't know what perfect looks like, I don't think, in a smart city, in a smart place, but we know what the fundamental good elements look like, and we know what the outcomes we're trying to achieve are. So I think it's continuing to be curious and learn. The potential for AI, for the algorithms, for machine learning and augmented reality, probably we can conceptualize them, but we're not actualizing them yet. So I think the infrastructure side, it's the poles and furniture. And then on the data and insights side, it's what we're doing with AI and ML that will really be where we see the benefits in the next three to five years.
And beyond too, I think. And I also think having more people in this space and interested in this space then brings that ethics side of things more to the fore as well, which I think is really important. And I think what I like about like the approach that New South Wales is taking is that it is bringing in all those different people. And, you know, you've got like people in the community know about your strategy, not necessarily everybody, but people know about your strategy. They're attending these events. I'm talking to councils. They know, you know, who they need to talk to. And, you know, I even had, you know, Sandy, your colleague, on a panel that I organized, and people loved it and they lapped it up and they went, oh, I'm involved in this space, which I think is something that has changed. And when we get more people involved, we get better questions asked, and then we can answer better as well. So I think that's really key. And then once we then move into these other, you know, more advanced spaces, people continue to ask those questions and go, oh, actually, or even just applications, right? Just like, oh, I've never, you know, if you're sitting there coding, you might not think of an application in a local council that could really offer a better service to somebody who doesn't have access now or whatever the case is. So, yeah, I am also excited about the future in that space.
Yeah, it's great. And I'm glad that you said that there are people that recognise team. You know, I've built a really talented but small team. And probably the key thing about all of us is that I think we all have those open to learning mindsets, and we're always keen to hear from people with ideas and help build the story that way. Every member of the team, I think, punches above their weight in terms of talent and also the networks that they build and maintain. And that's key, right? Keep sharing, keep learning, and keep growing.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Now, we're at the end, which is a bit sad because I've been really enjoying this conversation, but I think we can have another one at some point in the future. And hopefully I love digital, and I just said that, but I'm looking forward to coming down to New South Wales any moment now to meet up with the people I've been working with for more than the last 12 months, but it should be really good to catch up in person. And, you know, I heard you're really good at karaoke as well. So,
yeah, you should be careful who you believe, whose advice you take. I'm really looking forward to seeing you and others as well. It's been great to finally be on the podcast.
I'm excited. Okay. So, last question, how can people connect with you?
LinkedIn, my email, through the Smart Places at Planning. Send me comments in chats of meetings that we're at, or go through you and my smart communities, because you know how to find me.
I do. And we'll put the links in the show notes. And yes, if anyone wants a connection, let us know. That's been happening quite a lot recently. People reaching out and going, oh, I want to talk to this person. And I mean, majority of my guests are really keen to talk and collaborate, right? And really build this space. So thank you for coming on to the podcast.
Thanks for the opportunity.
Thanks, Simon. We will talk really soon.
Cool. See you, Zoe.
Bye.
The Smart Community Podcast is brought to you by My Smart Community. If you're trying to deal with disruption, not sure what technologies to buy, need to facilitate genuine collaboration, then we can help. Email hello@mysmart.community or head to www.mysmart.community/consulting.
Thanks so much for listening to the Smart Community Podcast. Show notes for this episode and all other episodes are available on our website, mysmart.community/podcast. If you have any questions for us or any of our guests, you can email hello@mysmart.community. You can also find us on the socials. We are on LinkedIn and Twitter @smartcomhq. That's com with two M's. If you are enjoying the podcast, please hit subscribe so you never miss an episode. And we would love for you to leave us a rating and review at wherever you listen. This really helps us reach more ears and eyes, so thank you for your support. As always, we hope you enjoyed listening to this episode as much as we enjoyed making it.
The Smart Community Podcast is what you're looking for.